Good morning. Welcome everyone to worship with St. Paul's United Methodist Church. We're so grateful for each of you who are here today, whether you join us in person or remotely, from around the corner or from around the globe, whether it's your first time worshiping with us, the first time in a long time, or the 100th time in a row, whatever your sexual orientation, gender identity, age, nation, race or station, this is God's house, and we joyfully welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ. Now for a few announcements. Our renovation, as you can tell, has begun. To help you keep up, weekly things to know about building status are being listed right at the beginning of the announcement section in the bulletin. This week, that includes how to enter the building and availability of restrooms, the all-important stuff. These updates will be included in the weekly email news that goes out on Thursday nights, so you'll want to keep up through those resources. The expectation is that office phones will be disconnected sometime this week or next, making email truly the best way to reach clergy and staff at St. Paul's. And again, note that while we plan to hold worship as regularly scheduled each Sunday, in person and live streamed, the church building and offices will be closed on weekdays throughout this process. As explained last week, Pastor Kate will be holding community office hours on Wednesdays in May and June. This Wednesday, May 18th, you can find her at the Adventure Playground at Wheaton Regional Park from 4 until 7. That sounds like fun, so join her there. Remember that Reverend Joey Heath Mason will join us for worship at both services next Sunday, May 22nd. Please wear your name tag. I forgot mine this morning and my hero brought it to me. But please, if you have it with you, put it on next week so that we can help Pastor Joey to get to know us. He will begin his new responsibilities here at St. Paul's in July. This summer, when there are 5 Sundays in a month, we'll use that 5th Sunday to bring everyone together at a single 10:30 service in the morning. Our first 5th Sunday will be the last Sunday of this month, May 29th. And on the very following Sunday, June 5th, which is Pentecost Sunday, we'll again worship at 10:30 only and outdoors across the street at Reinhardt Park. The guest preacher that morning will be the Baltimore Washington Conference's Bishop Latrell Easterling. That Sunday will also mark Pastor Pat's first Sunday back after her Sabbath renewal leave, as well as Confirmation Sunday. So please join us in the park or online for this special day of worship. Of course, on the following Sunday, which is June 12th, we'll be saying farewell to Pastor Kate as she prepares for her new appointment at Trinity UMC in Germantown. Be sure to look at the details in the bulletin about plans for that day. Also, please refer to this morning's bulletin, which is available in hard copy here in the sanctuary, as well as online, to the weekly email news and to our website at www.stpaulsk.org for details on ongoing studies being offered, contributing to, and applying for the St. Paul's Educational Award. Note that the application date has been extended to next Sunday, May 22nd. Also pay attention to the opportunity to provide breakfast items for the new women's shelter in Durwood, opportunity to participate in Pride events on the 11th and 25th of June, your chance to join the June choir, and St. Paul's new online shop. And please make note that there are cards prepared by the card ministry folks out here in the narthex this morning. Please pick one of those up and greet one of the folks who are not able to be with us here in worship this morning. And now I invite you to prepare your hearts for worship through the gift of music. Thanks.
Thank you. Please stand as you are able for the call to worship. We come to worship you, our Maker. Help us to pray like the lightning bug prays. May we praise you like the caterpillar. Guide us to pray like the snowy owl. Help us to be like the Venus flytrap, O God.
Thank you.
Let us join together in the opening prayer as printed in the bulletin. Creator God, maker of heaven and earth, maestro of the universe and all that is, shower us with your presence this day. Stir up within us a grateful heart, so that we may joyfully join all creation in singing your praise. Amen.
Thank you. Amen. I'd like to invite children in fifth grade and younger to come forward for the children's message today. On this side, obviously. And we have a special treat today because we're talking about all of creation today. And we're part of God's creation, right? But there are also creatures in our world that are part of creation, right? And all of us are called to praise God. Have a seat right here, if you'd like. And we have with us today wonderful David Weaver, who's going to lead us in a song that some of you may know, All God's Critters Got a Place in the Choir. I want to give him a chance to tune. Sorry.
Morning.
Good morning.
How are you all doing? You want to sing with me? Would that be all right? If I should, maybe, no, you don't. But I saw a couple head nods. All right. Well, this is a song called A Place in the Choir. And it's all about, as Dr. Baker said, about the fact that we all have a place in God's choir. Right? We all have a place here. But because it's a song about the choir, and we all have a place in it, that means we all have to sing. So the chorus goes like this. And it's printed in your bulletin for those of you here and online. All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing high, some sing out loud on telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. Yes, exactly. So there are two, if you don't get anything else, there are two words you need to know. Loud, okay? So when we sing the word loud, we're going to sing it loud. All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing high. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. There you go. Here we go. Ready? All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing high, some sing out on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got. Listen to the bass, it's the one on the bottom where the bullfrog croaks. The hippopotamus moans and groans, the big to-do. The old cow just goes moo. Everybody sing. All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing high, some sing out loud, the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got. Dogs and the cat, they take up the middle. The honeybee hums, the cricket fiddles, and the donny brays and the pony neighs. The old coyote howls. Here we go. All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing high, some sing out on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. Good clapping. Listen to the top where the little birds sing, oh, the melody, the high notes ringing, the hoot owl hollers over everything, the jaybird disagrees. Singing in the night, singing in the day, a little duck quacks, then is on his way, the possum ain't got much to say, the porcupine talks to himself. All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low, and some sing high. Some sing out loud, telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got. Simple song of living, sung everywhere. By the ox and the fox and the grizzly bear. The grumpy alligator and the hawk above. The sly raccoon and the turtle dove. Last time. God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing high. Some sing out on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands and pause. All God's critters got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing high. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands and pause. Woo! Good job singing.
Amen. Thank you, David Weaver, for leading us in that spirited song of animal praising. And now it's time. But we need to pray. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the gift of praise. Thank you for the privilege to be in your choir. Be with us as we go on to the rest of our day, praising you. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. And now it's time for Sunday school. You can, so kindergarten through second graders can go with Miss Hannah here, and older kids can go with Mrs. Burak. Thank you very much.
Sometimes our littlest ones do all the praying we need, and my job feels a little extraneous. It is our joy and our privilege as members of God's great choir to pray for one another. One of the ways we do that is through our prayer waves call every Wednesday. You have a little yellow pieces of paper in your pews. Yeah, there you go. Rich is demonstrating for you. Thank you, Vanna. And we invite you, if you have a prayer request that you'd like us to lift up or that you'd just like me to know about, to fill that out and to put those in the offering plate as it comes around later in the service. We also invite you, if this is your first time or your 100th, to make sure that you fill out your attendance pad and pass it on down the pew so that we know who is here, who is not here. If it's your first time and you'd like to offer us some information, a telephone number or an address, we would love to reach out later in the week with additional words of welcome for you. Despite the joy that we just saw, it has been a heavy week in our lives, in the life of our nation and our world. And today felt like it needed something more than the extemporaneous prayer I usually do. So with his permission, I have borrowed and adapted some words from one of my respected senior colleagues, the Reverend Dr. Joe Daniels at Emory Fellowship in DC for today's pastoral prayer. Would you join me? Holy God, we come in humility before you this morning, knowing that you are a God through whom all things are possible. We come in moments of great need, remembering that you are our Savior. You taught us to come to you when we are weak and heavy laden, that you will grant us rest. Well, Lord, we come to you this day weak and heavy, burdened by all that is going on in our homes, our nation, and our world. Lord, please hear our voices and give us rest. We grieve, O Lord, as we pass a milestone none of us wanted to see. 1 million dead of COVID-19. We are family members and friends who have lost loved ones to the virus or been unable to be present with loved ones who have died over the course of the pandemic. We are individuals who have tested positive and seek to get well in the midst of our shame and guilt, both external and internal. We are those working the front lines while others stay home. We are the healthcare workers, teachers, paraeducators, and clergy who are exhausted and overwhelmed by what's being asked of us. We are the grocery and drugstore and daycare workers nervous about going to work. We are the parents juggling the demands of jobs and family, sometimes making huge sacrifices to keep our children safe, sometimes spending every day dreading the school drop-off line. We are the children and youth whose formative years are being stolen, lonely and depressed, trying so hard to do our best. We are weak and we are burdened. Lord, hear our voices and give us rest. We also come to you, this day, Holy One, grieving yet another mass shooting, yet another community traumatized by racially motivated violence. We name and repent once again of the sin of racism and the ways that it has insidiously rooted itself among us even now, O Lord, long after we should have known better. We are the people of color who must wrestle with a many-headed hydra of fear and hate, even in places which ought to be safe. We are the white people who can and must do more to address the ways we teach and affirm racism in our schools, our communities, and yes, God, even in our churches. We are beyond our own abilities. We are weak and we are burdened. Hear our voices and give us rest. We come in light of protests around the country as women and those assigned female at birth fear for their futures and for the future of our nation. As our trust in one another and our elected officials erodes, as internal conflict becomes more and more violent, we turn to you, O God. We are weak and we are burdened. Hear our voices and give us rest. O God, would you hear our pleas for healing, feel our yearning for forgiveness, and rejoice in our desire for restoration. We come to you asking for comfort in our losses, healing in illness of mind and body, protection from the plagues of COVID and racism and misogyny. Because we know, O Lord, that only you can heal. Only you can strengthen us for the road ahead. Only you, O God, can save us from ourselves. And we trust, even amidst all this, that you will indeed save us. So as we offer our praises to you this morning, as we offer the prayers that we've named and those that lay in the silence of our hearts, we listen, we trust, and we wait for you as we pray together the prayer that Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from the Psalter, Psalm 148. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him all his angels. Praise him all his hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created. He established them forever and ever. He fixed their bounds, which cannot be passed. Praise the Lord from the earth, you sea monsters and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and frost, stormy wind for fulfilling his command, mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all cattle, creeping things and flying birds, kings of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth, young men and women alike, old and young together. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His glory is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people. Praise for all his faithful, for the people of Israel who are close to him. Praise the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Good morning. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we come before you with humble hearts, asking that you fill us with your Spirit to hear and heed your message for us today. Knit us together so closely that we can't help but join the chorus of all creation in singing your praise. Amen. Some of you may be familiar with one of the most wildly popular word games out there, Wordle. I see some hands waving. Wordle is a simple online game that challenges people to find a five-letter word in six guesses. I first learned of the game when Jimmy Fallon led his audience through the experience on late night TV. I was both fascinated and intimidated by this new art form, although not nearly as much as I was when Trivial Pursuit had its day. I like words though, so this sounded like a possible new hobby for me, but I wonder, why five-letter words? I mean, why not six? The official Scrabble Player's Dictionary claims there are 8,996 words with five letters that are available for use in word games. But that same Scrabble guide boasts that there are more than 20,000 six-letter words up for grabs. I mean, wouldn't Wordle have a longer shelf life if it were made up of six-letter words? After all, Wordle is six letters long, just saying. There is one six-letter word that dominates our scripture reading this morning. The word praise appears 13 times in these 14 verses of Psalm 148. Which George read so well for us. It appears eight times in just the first four verses alone. I'm thinking that must mean we need to pay attention. The Hebrew word for praise used in this psalm, interestingly, happens to be a five-letter word, halal, the definition of which may surprise you. It means to emit rays of light, to shine brightly, to cause another to shine through one's actions or words, to look forward, and even to boast. Halal is praise that is unrestrained. Imagine the scene in ancient Israel when David danced and praised God in ecstatic delight as he watched the Ark of the Lord being brought back to Jerusalem. David's unreserved praise was halal praise. Throughout the Tanakh, Old Testament, our life is seen as a journey, and God is the shining light that guides us. This psalm calls on creation, both animate and inanimate, to praise the Lord. Halal, when activated, is not a quiet expression, but rather bright, flashing praise that draws everyone's attention, like a light burning brilliantly in the darkness. In this psalm, praise is first set into motion from the heavens, the heights, the angels, the host, followed by the sun, moon, shining stars, along with the highest heavens, and the waters above the heavens. These things all seem to us to be voiceless. How are they to praise the Lord? Nevertheless, the psalmist continues, "Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded, and they were created." Once the heavens are engaged in this jubilee, the earthly realm joins the chorus. Sea monsters, all deeps, even the weather fulfills his command. Fire and hail, snow and frost, stormy wind. The orchestra swells even still to include mountains and hills, fruit trees and cedars, wild animals, cattle, creeping things, and flying birds. Finally, praise from the peoples, kings, rulers, young and old. The particulars in this passage illustrate that the invitation to praise God is inclusive. No one is left out. So, Meg, what does this have to do with loving our wild neighbors, which you may have noticed is the title of the sermon? Well, you may recall a story from the Gospel of Luke when a religious scholar asked Jesus, "What must I do to gain eternal life?" Jesus responded with a question, "What is written in the law?" The legal expert answered, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." Jesus says, "Good answer. Do it and you'll live." But the scholar wanted Jesus to define who exactly is our neighbor. Well, Jesus answered him with a parable of the Good Samaritan, the person who tended to the needs of a man injured along the road, unlike the priest and the Levite who passed by without raising a finger. We most often hear this parable through the lens of other human beings. But are not those in the animal kingdom also our neighbors? How often do we even think of loving our wild neighbors? English writer and naturalist David Attenborough says, "Sometimes we need to take a step back and remember that we have no greater right to be here than any other animal. We know from scriptures that we are to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our neighbor as ourselves. Are not God's critters also our neighbors?" There's a passage in the book of Job that's worth noting here. While Zophar the Namathite was visiting Job in his distress, Job said, "Ask the animals what they think. Let them teach you. Let the birds tell you what's going on. Put your ear to the earth, learn the basics. Listen, the fish in the ocean will tell you their stories. Isn't it clear that they all know and agree that God is sovereign, that he holds all things in his hand, every living soul, yes, every breathing creature?" When was the last time you sat and just listened to the birds? What do you think the animals could teach us about God? Have you ever listened to a mockingbird long enough to hear him or herself, repeat herself or himself, right? No, I have, it doesn't work. They never repeat themselves. Reverend Marcy Auld Glass writes, "Humanity is adept at pretending we are kind of a big deal. Psalm 148 is a corrective to human hubris and self-importance. Our understanding of God's call requires a vulnerable listening. We matter. We are not all that matters." There are times, though, when it's just plain hard to praise God. Are we just supposed to pull up our bootstraps and praise while keeping our raw emotions at bay? I imagine there are at least two times when we don't feel like praising God. One, when things aren't going our way, and two, when things are going so swell that praise feels unnecessary. How do we sing praise when war rages in Ukraine, when COVID spikes again, when people are forced from their homeland, when poverty has the upper hand, when the economy is tanking? How do we praise God when the world is hurting? Praise is not a means to an end. It's not an if-then bargaining event. Okay, if I praise you, then you will dispense the item I requested on the divine vending machine. God, I pressed D8, but the raisinettes I wanted didn't drop down. Mother Teresa is known for many things, but I wanted to call attention to one of her writings. She says, "People are often unreasonable and self-centered. Forgive them anyway. If you are kind, people may accuse you of ulterior motives. Be kind anyway. The good you do today may be forgotten tomorrow. Do good anyway." It seems appropriate to say, in that same spirit, there's much suffering in the world. Praise God anyway. Engaging in praise requires careful attention and intention. Theologian Catherine Kelsey writes that praise requires noticing both what has occurred in the past and what God is already doing here, in this place, in this moment. It is in our noticing that we move toward gratitude for what we see, and gratitude then transports us to the threshold of trust, deepening our relationship with God by acknowledging our dependence on God and on the rest of creation. Noticing begets gratitude, and gratitude begets trust. The more we praise, the more we let go of things that are really not praiseworthy. The act of praise presents a wonderful gift to the one doing the praising. It takes the focus off of ourselves. Focus. Now, there's an excellent wordle-worthy word. Praise is an action, not an idea, and it inherently impedes the vicious cycle of self-centeredness. Praise changes things. In our praise, and especially in our praising together in community, we grow, we connect, and we become more fully who we are called to be. For in him we live and move and have our being. As part of God's wonderful creation, we were made to halal, to shine, hand in hand, or hand in hoof, with our wild neighbors. So whether you wordle or not, Let your 5, 6, or even 4-letter words praise the Lord. Amen.
This moment in worship is an opportunity for us to praise God with our gifts. I don't know about you, but at Shea McFulton, we've been looking at our retirement accounts and our stock portfolios and our grocery bills with shock and dismay over the past several months. And I know that each of you is feeling that pinch as well. I want you to know that however much or however little you have given or are able to give, that your presence is in and of itself a great gift. We are so grateful, not just for your treasure, but for your time and for your talents, for each and every way that you offer back to God of yourselves in this community. I invite our ushers now to come forward to accept our tithes and offerings as our choir leads us in the offertory.
Yeah.
be seated and join me in a word of prayer. Holy and gracious God, you have indeed given us every good thing. And as we offer back our gifts of time and talent and treasure to you, we pray that you would multiply them, that you would do things we cannot imagine with the things that we have offered. Help us, God, not to be a reservoir which hoards the gifts that you have given us, but a channel through which every good thing reaches from this place to all the places where your light and life are most needed. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Love and serve and praise the Lord, knowing that God is with you and all creation praises with you. Amen.